Hey, what's up, Blender users? I'm Jonathan, and in today's video, we'll talk about tracking. More specifically, about object tracking combined with camera tracking. This method allows us to not only add CG objects to our tracked object, like I showed you in this video, but also to our world, and we can even make these two systems interact with each other. Oh, and by the way, if you enjoy my content, consider subscribing because I upload a new video every Saturday. And with that said, let's get straight into the video. To start off, you of course need to film some footage. This is what I recorded with tracking markers on the ground and on my object that I want to track, which is of course my hand. I then planned on having a cube fall from my hand onto our world ground. So with this footage ready, we first want to convert it into an image sequence. We will do this so we don't have frame rate issues in the end, and also I do want to scale down this 4K footage to 1080p, just because I do not need much more. So in Blender, let's switch to Video Sequencer, and first of all, in the Dimensions tab, let's set it to 4K, which is our base resolution, and now let's set our frame rate to 25, because this is what I recorded this video in. We can now just drag and drop this video onto our timeline and delete this strip right here. This is just the audio. If we change to sequencer/preview, we can also see our video. And if we now adjust the slider, you can see that we can change the resolution. And because I just want it in 1080p, I'll set it to 50. Set the compression to 0%. And in the color management tab, set it to standard. This way the colors won't get affected. And now we can change the output path. And after you have trimmed your video to the spot you want to edit, you can export it as an image sequence with Ctrl and F12. And you can see that in my images folder, I already have this image sequence ready. And now we can import it into Blender. So in a new scene, let's go to this plus icon right here and under VFX select motion tracking. This workspace will help us with, of course, motion tracking. So now let's click on open and locate our folder. Make sure that you're sorting by name and not, for example, by date modified. Your image sequence has to start with your first image. So let's now select everything with A and click on Open Clip. Now our clip is loaded into Blender and we can start by setting our scene frames and prefetch our video. Prefetching means that our video is preloaded and so we can easily play it back. If it doesn't prefetch all the way and you have a lot of RAM, you can always press F4, go into Preferences, and under System, you can give your video sequencer a higher memory cache limit. I want to start by solving the camera motion. So in this track panel, I make sure that I selected the camera object. And now I'll start tracking these markers right here. You can add new markers by control clicking onto your video. You can scale the marker. This box means that this is what it will be searching, and it will be searching in this area. You can show this area with Alt and S. So let's add a couple of markers. And right now I'm using the location motion model, but for a few markers, I'll also use perspective, just because I always like to have a variety of markers. So Blender has a lot of information. You can now see that I change it to perspective, and I'll do these markers right here with the perspective motion model. Okay, great. Once you have all your markers set, we can select them all. And either with this button right here or Ctrl T, we can track them forward. This mostly works fine, but sometimes the markers just stop tracking, like you can see right here. And so I'll just select, for example, this one that stopped tracking on frame 214, go one frame forward, manually move it to the spot where it belongs and track it forward with Ctrl T. And I will repeat this process for the other markers that stopped tracking. And just like that, all of our markers have been tracked, and it actually looks quite good. We do not have any outcasts, and so I think we are ready to solve our camera motion. To do this, we will have to go to the Solve panel right here, and click on Solve Camera Motion. And you can see that we are getting a solve error of 0.24. This is pretty good, because everything under a solve error of 1 is pretty much usable, everything above it is not ready to be used. But we can of course refine it a bit. For example, we can go under camera and enter our sensor width. You can just Google it for your camera. I know that mine is 23.5. And under lens, you can enter your focal length. If you do not know yours, you can just solve for focal length, and just like that it solved it, and the solve error even got a little bit better. You can see that we are setting a keyframe range, and right now it is set from 1 to 30. You can have it automatic set by Blender by just activating this checkbox, or you can set it manually, and sometimes changing it will improve your results. So I suggest if you have a high solve error, you play around with them a little bit. But for now, this is pretty good. So let's start tracking our object. For this, we will need to add an object. So click on this plus sign right here, and we can rename it to hand. You can also see that all of our tracking markers disappeared. This is because they are bound to the camera object. And now we can start by tracking these markers right here. This will be the same procedure as for the camera, so I will not go over it again, but just skip to once I'm ready. Tracking markers on a hand is of course a lot harder for Blender, just because of all the motion, so it might require some manual tracking. And to do this, you can just go frame by frame with the arrow keys, and by moving your tracking marker, it automatically sets a keyframe. So, now I have tracked a lot of markers, and if you have tracked too few and try to solve the object motion, Blender will give you an error, so make sure you have enough markers. But now, after I clicked on solve object motion, you can see that we have a pretty high solve error. So let's try to fix it. Let's firstly go on a display and click on info, and now we can see the average error for each tracking marker. And so I'm trying to find the one with the highest, which is this one, and this one right here seems to throw off Blender. So let's see what we can do to fix it. One fix often is to just delete it and solve again, so let's try it. And you can see that the solve error got a little bit better, but I want to get it under 1. To filter for tracks with a high solve error, we can use the cleanup tab. We can enter in an error, for example 1.5, and I always use select as a type. Now we can click on clean tracks. And we can see that this one still has a pretty high solve error. And now let's see what we can do to fix it. And I'll first just try deleting it. And the solve error is under 1, and this is pretty good. So let's just go with this. Now it's time to set up our 3D scene. So in this viewport window right here, select everything and delete it. Also the collection. And in the camera object, we can now click on set as background and set up tracking scene. And now you can see that we have all our markers from the ground, as well as the markers of my hand. But you can see that this doesn't really align well, so let's try to fix it. First of all, in the camera object, we need to set the scale, origin and floor. So let's choose this marker right here and click on set origin. Now we need to set a scale, so let's select a second marker and change the distance. Somehow OBS didn't record this part. I set the scale to 0.03 for 3 centimeters. And for the floor, I selected one more marker, so Blender could calculate the floor plane. And this looks pretty good. So now we can just rotate the plane, and you can see that it aligns with our floor. Now there's just one thing that is off, and this is that my hand is this far away from the ground, because I aligned them pretty much on the Z-axis. So with our hand object selected, we can change the object scale until it fits, and I'll just eyeball it to around right here. Great! Now we're done with the motion tracking part, and we can start by adding in an object that interacts with both systems. Let's change to our layout tab, and we can firstly delete our light because we won't be needing it. And you can see that if I zoom in, all of the tracking markers have disappeared. We can re-enable them by going to viewport overlays, motion tracking, and we can make them smaller by adjusting the size to maybe 0.05. Let's delete this cube, because I'll add in a physics cube later. And have a look at our setup. You can see that we have a plane and two collections, one for the foreground, one for the background. And now I have to re-add the cube because I want to show you something. And this is that anything in the foreground should go into the foreground collection. And anything that should be a shadow catcher should go into the background collection. And of course we have to switch to cycles. And now we can, with the plane selected, change its visibility to Shadow Catcher, which is already default with the plane that was added in with the motion tracking scene. Now you can see that if we go into rendered mode and set our background to transparent, that we do not see our shadow. This is because the background collection in our foreground view layer is set to holdout. This is why it is so bright. This won't be visible later, but in the background view layer we can see our shadow because the foreground collection is set to indirect only. This way we do not see our object, but just the indirect influence in our scene. Great, now that this is cleared up, we can start by adding in a shadow catcher plane onto my hand. So let's add in a second plane, of course in the background collection, and in the constraints panel, we want to add an object solver. Select the hand as the object and the camera as camera. Now you can see that the plane is moving with my hand. We can now just scale it down and place it right onto my hand, and we can align it a lot better using these tracking markers. Now it is aligned to our hand, and it should be moving with it. And this is the case. Now let's use this cube and make it fall from my hand onto the ground. So let's move it up, scale it down, and place it right above my hand. To make it interact with both scenes, I do not want to constrain it to my hand, but I'll make it a rigid body type. This way we can make it fall from our hand to the ground. I'll set it to active, dynamic, and of course not animated. But if I play it, you can now see that it just falls down. So let's select our hand plane. Also select rigid body, but now passive and animated. Now you can see that the cube is colliding with it, but it is just slipping downwards and falling. We can fix this by adjusting the surface response and adding in a lot more friction. So let's do this for both the cube and the ground, and let's also rotate the cube so it is aligned with the hand. Now if we play it, you can see that the cube sticks to the hand. Awesome. And once I move my hand, you can see that the cube falls down as intended. But of course it should land on this plane right here. So I'll also make this rigid body passive. And now you can see that once I move my hand, the cube falls down to this plane. Of course there are some things to tweak. For example, the hand is still not completely correctly aligned with the ground. So I can just go back to the motion tracking tab and give the object a different scale, for example 4. But now we have to realign our plane, which we can only do on frame 1 because of the baked rigid body animation. And we can also replace our cube, and just like this it all works. Of course we can play around with friction so we can give the cube a better simulation, but all in all this should work. There are just two more things to consider, and this is the lighting and shadows. We of course want to light our scene with the exact same light as in our footage, and I'll just fake it using an area light, which I'm gonna make not that bright. And you can see that in the background the shadows also work, but there's one problem, and this is that of course this plane is still not a shadow catcher, which we can just enable right here. But right now, the cube is casting a shadow through the hand onto our ground, which is of course not what I want. So, to fix this, we can just get the exact moment the cube is falling from the hand onto the ground, which is right here. And one frame before that, we can select this ground plane, make it hold out, and animate it off. This way, in the frames before that, no shadow will be casted onto this plane. But once the cube falls from the hand onto the plane, a shadow will be casted. Motion blur is already enabled, which is great, but you should still adjust the shutter to the setting you had set in your camera. For me this works out, so I can just now render the scene. And you can see that it already is composited correctly. If you do want to composite these elements in another program, I would suggest you to export the shadow and the foreground separately. To do this, you can just hook up the foreground to your composite output. This way it will be output to the directory you specify in here. And to export the shadows, hook it up to a file output node. This way it will be rendered to this path right here. And yeah, this is basically it. This is how you can track an object as well as a camera in the same scene. If you enjoyed this tutorial and if you learned something, consider liking and subscribing, and we'll see you in the next video next Saturday.